brought Anikó Sohár here from Hungary so that she could be part of the event. Then we have the School of English, who brought us Jane, who will introduce herself in a second. The Trinity Centre for Literary and Cultural Translation, which brought you me. The Library of Trinity College Dublin, without which we couldn't do any of this graphic-based research because they hold all the books. And when I say all, I mean all of them in every language. Then we have the Embassy of Poland, who very kindly brought a Polish translator, Piotr Cholewa. Sorry, I said it perfectly earlier, and of course, in front of an audience, I get it wrong. And then the Embassy of France and the Alliance Française, who have brought Patrick Couton, the French translator. Then the Institute of Cervantes, who have brought María Ferrer, who is a Spanish translator. And I haven't missed anybody, I don't think. Together, the Embassy of Poland, France, and the Alliance Française, and the Institute of Cervantes are the unique group. So, I've introduced everybody, I think. So, what we're going to do today is we're going to be discussing how Pratchett's unique brand of humour is translated into other languages. So that's why we've brought this collection of translators into various languages. We're going to focus on the book Pyramids, if you didn't see that in the advertisement for the... Yes, that's it. The advertisement for the event. So what we're going to do is I've picked a specific part of the text which I find particularly funny. So each one of the translators will introduce themselves.
very different character for Pratchett than he is in Tom Webb's School Days. So I'm going to read the section. This is early on in the book. Let's see. You carry it yourself, said Chittenden. That's the rule around here. Tepic clove to the trunk. It was an intriguing notion. At home, we've people who do that, he said. Eunuchs and so on. We should have brought one with you. They don't travel well, he said. And in fact, he'd adamantly refused all suggestions that a small retinue should accompany him, and Dios spoke for days. That was not how a member of the royal blood should go forth into the world, he said. Tepic had remained firm. He was pretty certain that assassins were expected to go about the business accompanied by weren't expected to go about the business accompanied by handmaidens and butlers. Now, however, the idea seemed to have some merit. He gave the trunk an experimental heave and managed to get it across his shoulders. Your people are pretty rich then, said Chittenden, ambling along beside him. Tepic thought about this. No, not really, he said. It mainly grow melons and garlic and stand in the streets and shout, "Hello." This is your parents you're talking about, said Chittenden, puzzled. Oh, them? No. My father's a pharaoh. My mother was a concubine, I think. I thought that was some sort of vegetable. I don't think so. We've never really discussed it. Anyway, she died when I was young. How dreadful, said Chittenden cheerfully. She went for a moonlight swim and what turned out to be a crocodile, Tepic, trying politely not to be hurt. My father's in commerce, said Chittenden as they passed through the archway. That's fascinating, said Tepic dutifully. He felt quite broken by all these new experiences and added, I've never been to commerce, but I understand the very fondly. Over the next hour or two, Chittenden rambled gently through life as though he'd already worked it all out, introduced Tepic to the various mysteries of the dormitories, the classrooms, and the plumbing. He left the plumbing until last for all sorts of reasons. Not any, he said. Well, there's buckets and things, said Tepic vaguely. Lots of servants. Bit old-fashioned, this king of yours. Tepic nodded. It's the pyramids, he said. They take all the money. Expensive things, I should imagine. Not particularly. They're just made of stone, Tepic said. We've got lots of stone and sand. Stone and sand. We're really big on them. If you ever need any stone and sand, we're the people for you. It's fitting out the inside. It's really expensive. We're still avoiding paying for grandfathers, and that wasn't very big, just three chambers. Tepic turned and looked out the window. They were back to the dormitory at this point. The whole kingdom's in debt, he said quietly. I mean, even our debts are in debt. That's why I'm here, really. Someone in our house needs to earn some money. A royal prince can't hang around looking ornamental anymore. He's got to get out and do something useful in the community. Chittenden leaned on the windowsill. Couldn't you just take some stuff out of the pyramids then? He said. Oh, don't be silly. Sorry. Tepic gloomily watched the figures below. There's a lot of people here, he said, to change the subject. I didn't realize it would be so big. Shivered. It was so cold, he added. People drop out all the time, said Chittenden. Can't stand the cold. The important thing is to know what's what and who's who. See that fellow over there? Tepic followed his pointing finger to a group of older students who were lounging against pillars by the entrance. That big one, face like the end of your boot. That's Flymon. Watch out for him. If he invites you for toast at the studio, don't go. And who's the little kid with the curls, said Tepic. He pointed to a small black dwarf, receiving the attentions of a washed out looking lady. She was licking around and dug out smudges off his face. And when she stopped that, she straightened his tongue. Chittenden craved to see. Oh, just some new kid, he said. Arthur, someone. Still hanging on to his mum, you see. He won't last long. Oh, I don't know, said Tepic. We do too, and we've lasted for thousands of years.
Thank you so much. So what happens to Arthur when he goes into the door and starts praying?
Well, so in Tom Brown's school days, Arthur sits down to say his prayers, and all the other boys are shocked because nobody says prayers in boarding school. And he dutifully says his prayers anyway. And then the next night, all the boys say their prayers because they're sort of shamed into being better boys. But in pyramids, Arthur most drives a goat to sacrifice. He's sort of a Satanist, and that's his way of saying his prayers. And at times, all the boys have goats, you know, they want to kind of practice these slightly bizarre and arcane religions in the middle of the dormitory. It's just this wonderful parallel between it.
normalnie to wytrzymałem. To okropna stadia uprzejmym Tiller poszła popływać przy świetle księżyca w czymś, co okazało się krokodylem. Tepik starał się nie okazywać, jak uraziła go racja chłopca. Mój ojciec pracuje w handlu, powiedział Tiller, gdy przychodził pod okiem wejścia. Fascynujące, przyznał wcześniej Tepik. Przytłaczały go te wszystkie nowe doświadczenia. Nigdy nie byłem w handlu, ale słyszałem, że to wspaniali ludzie. Przez kolejną godzinę czy dwie Tiller, który kroczył przez życie spokojnie, jakby już dawno nie rozpracował, prowadzał Tepika w rozmaite tajemnice internatów, klas i kanalizacji. Kanalizacje z różnych powodów zostały na sam koniec. Żadnych nie dowierzał. Mamy wiadra i inne rzeczy, odpadłujące Tepik i dużo słychać. Trochę staromodne jest to twoje królestwo. Tepik skinął głową, to przez piramidę pierwszą. Pochłaniają wszystkie pieniądze. Przypuszczam, są kosztowne, niespecjalnie. Mamy z kamieni, chłopiec westro. Mamy mnóstwo kamieni i piasku. Kamień i piasek. W tym jesteśmy dobrzy. Gdybyś kiedyś przyjął kamieni i piasku, jesteśmy właściwymi ludźmi. To wykończenie wnętrza jest naprawdę kosztowne. Wciąż nie spłaciliśmy rachunku za dziadkowo, ale przecież nie była duża, tylko trzy komory. Tepik odwrócił się i wyjrzał przez okno. Podczas rozmowy wrócili do wspólnej sypialni. Całe królestwo jest zadłużone, wyznał cicho. Nawet nasze długi są zadłużone. Właściwie to z tego powodu przyjechałem. Ktoś z rodziny musi zarabiać jakieś pieniądze. Następca tronu nie może się już uczyć po pałacu i udawać ornamentu. Musi wziąć się do pracy i zrobić coś pożytecznego dla społeczeństwa. Czyli oparł dłonią parapet. A nie moglibyście zdjąć z piramid trochę towaru? Zapytał. Nie żartuję. Przepraszam. Tepik spoglądał po sam niego. Mnóstwo ludzi zauważył, próbując zmienić temat. Nie sądziłem, że szkoła będzie taka duża, to zawsze, taka zimna. Ludzie ciągle odpadają, nie wytrzymują nauki. Najważniejsze to wiedzieć, co jest co i kto jest kto. Widzisz tego? Wskazał palcem grupę starszych uczniów stojących między kolumnami przy wejściu. Ten wysoki z twarzą człowiek to flamin. Uważaj na niego, jeśli cię zaprosi do swojej pracowni na grzankę o pięciu. A kim jest ten dzieciak z flamin? Zapytał ten. Wskazał chłopca, którym zajmowała się wyblakła z wyglądu kobieta. Lizała chusteczkę i ścierała wyimaginowane ślady grudu z jego twarzy. Kiedy skończyła, poprawiono pomóżnik. Fider wyciągnął się. To po prostu nowy dzieciak. Artur, jak myślał, mam nie synek, jak widzę, przetrwa do tego. Nie był mi taki pewny. My też jesteśmy w pewnym sensie moimi synkami, a przetrwaliśmy tysiące lat.
When you started translating Pratchett,
experience in writing basically. But I did homework and I've read the book. I've thought about the translation issues in this text, and I think that we can really find some good debate with the different translations and the strategies adopted by each of the translators. I can only give my opinion because I didn't translate this, but it's not an easy job. I have always been a defender of the invisibility of the translators. I don't want to talk very much about myself. I have been translating for 20 years since I started with the Sandman of Dreams, and then Couton came to me from the same publisher, my editorial in Spain. And that happened because I was allotted into comic book translation. I was a collaborator, a regular contributor to different comic book series. At that time, 20 years ago, in Spain, comic books and manga, I also translate Japanese, included this section, these pages at the end, where the readers sent their thoughts. It was like a mailbox. I don't know, some people are very young here and you might have seen that. But they included those pages where readers share their thoughts about one series or one character, one particular story. So sometimes those letters were made up by me, but sometimes they were real. And that's how I was into the comic book world. And Norma Editorial published the Sandman. So they started publishing the works of Neil Gaiman, and finally they translated Good Omens. So that's, I was in the right place at the right moment, I guess. So that's how Terry Pratchett came to me, or I found Terry Pratchett in my portfolio. So of course I was thrilled as a fan of Neil Gaiman, and I got to know about the humor of Terry Pratchett. And with time, at that time I wasn't capable of telling apart the part written by Terry Pratchett and the part written by Neil Gaiman. But with time, having read more of the words of Pratchett, I can now say, and yeah, and I can feel the difference between the two words mixed in Good Omens. And reading this part of Pyramids, this extract of Pyramids, I can also think about my own translation of Good Omens. So after reading the text in Spanish, when the rest of the translators talk about their translations, I think we can discuss about what was done in the 90s, what is done now, and how you readers and fans like to read a translation. I think that's important too, because the evolution of translation techniques or translating texts has a lot to do with what the fandom is expecting. I think translators are the readers, the audience has an impact on what we do in our texts. So mainly now I'm translating, I'm in the audiovisual translation field, but I also translate sometimes fantasy pieces, fantasy books, more based on video games or TV shows, commercial literature, really. And I also run an independent publishing house, my small, tiny publishing house called Takotombo Books, focused on Japanese literature. I lived in Japan, I worked on my piece there. So all this started before going to Japan, and then when I came back from Japan, I started my own translation business. And I switched a little bit to audiovisual, more than literary translation. So I'm going to stop not talking about me. And let's Tienes que llevarlo tú, dijo Broncano. Es la regla, ¿entiendes? Tepic contempló el. Parecía de lo más intrigante. casa tenemos personas que se encargan de ese tipo de cosas, dijo. Eunuco, sí, deberías haber traído uno contigo. Los viajes les sientan muy mal, dijo Tepi. De hecho, había rechazado tozudamente todas las sugerencias de que debía ir acompañado por un pequeño séquito, y Dios había estado de muy mal humor durante varios días. El gran sacerdote opinaba que ningún miembro del linaje real debería aventurarse por el mundo de aquella forma, pero Tepic había seguido firme en su decisión. Estaba casi seguro de que los asesinos no iban a trabajar acompañados por criadas y trompeteros, pero ahora... Bueno, quizá no hubiera sido tan mala idea. Tepic empujó el baúl para averiguar lo que pesaba, tiró de él y consiguió colocárselo sobre los hombros. Ronca los puso a su lado y empezaron a caminar. Así que tus viejos son bastante ricos, ¿eh? Preguntó Broncano. Tepic pensó en la pregunta. No, la verdad es que no lo son, dijo por fin. Los que aún pueden moverse cultivan melones, ajos y esa clase de cosas. Ah, sí, y de vez en cuando salen a la calle y gritan ¡hurra! Oye, ¿estamos hablando de tus padres o no? Preguntó Broncano poniendo cara de perplejidad. Oh, ¿te referías a ellos? No, mi padre es faraón. Mi madre creo que era concubina. Creía que eso era una variedad de hortaliza. No, me parece que no. Bueno, la verdad es que nunca llegamos a hablar del tema y murió cuando yo era bastante pequeño. ¡Qué terrible! Dijo Don Carlos con voz jovial. Fue a bañarse a la luz de la luna en lo que resultó ser un cocodrilo. Tepic estaba lo suficientemente bien educado para intentar no sentirse herido por la reacción del chico. Mi padre tiene un comercio, dijo Don Carlos mientras pasaban por debajo del arco que daba acceso al edificio principal. ¡Qué interesante! Dijo Tepic cumpliendo con lo que se esperaba de él. Tantas experiencias nuevas estaban empezando a afectarle. Nunca he tenido ninguno, pero me han comentado que son muy fieles y cariñosos. Durante las 2 horas siguientes, Broncano, quien se movía por la vida con tanta calma y seguridad en sí mismo, como si esta no tuviera secretos para él, se encargó de que Tepic se fuese familiarizando con los misterios de los dormitorios, las aulas y la fontanería. Broncano dejó la fontanería para el final, una decisión para que toda clase de buenas razones. Pero nada de nada. Tenemos cubos y esas cosas, dijo Tepic. Le habría gustado ser un poco más claro, pero no podía. Y montones de sirvientes, naturalmente. Ese reino tuyo está un poquito anticuado, ¿no? Tepic asintió. Es por las pirámides, dijo. Nos gastamos todo el dinero en ellas. Ya, supongo que esos trastos deben de salir carísimos, ¿no? No especialmente. Están hechas de piedra. Tepic suspiró. Tenemos toda la piedra que quieras, dijo, y mucha arena. No, sí, estamos muy bien surtidos tanto de una cosa como de la otra. Si alguna vez necesitas arena y unas cuantas piedras, te aconsejo que acudas a nosotros. Lo que sale realmente caro es el interior. Aún no hemos terminado de pagar la del abuelo, que no era muy grande. Solo tenía 3 cámaras, ¿sabes? Tepic giró sobre sí mismo y miró por la ventana. Ya llevaban un rato en el dormitorio. Todo el reino está endeudado, dijo en voz baja. Estamos tan endeudados que, bueno, hasta tenemos deudas sobre las deudas. Por eso estoy aquí. Alguien de la casa debe ganar un poco de dinero. Un príncipe de sangre real ya no puede pasarse la vida sirviendo de adorno. Tiene que salir al gran mundo y hacer algo útil para la comunidad. Broncano apoyó los brazos en la mesa de la ventana. ¿Y no podríais sacar algo de todo eso que dices habéis metido dentro de las pirámides? Preguntó. No digas bobadas, perdona. Tepic inclinó la cabeza y contempló con expresión lúgubre las siluetas que se movían por debajo de la ventana. Aquí hay montones de personas, dijo para cambiar el tema. No me había imaginado que esto sería tan grande, se estremeció, ni tan frío, añadió. Hay abandonos a cada momento, dijo Broncano. No pueden aguantar el ritmo y se van. Lo importante es saber qué es qué y quién es quién. ¿Ves a ese chaval de ahí? Tepic siguió la dirección indicada por su dedo y vio a un grupo de estudiantes veteranos apoyados en las columnas de la entrada. El corpulento, el que tiene la cara como la puntera de tu bota, es Garroto. Ten cuidado con él. Si te invita a tomarte con tostadas en su estudio, no aceptes, ¿entendido? ¿Y quién es el bajito de los rizos? Preguntó Tepic. Señaló con el dedo a un jovencito que estaba recibiendo las atenciones de una dama bastante anciana que no parecía encontrarse muy bien. La dama no paraba de lamer el pañuelo con la punta de la lengua y lo pasaba por la cara del jovencito como si quisiera quitarle alguna mancha. Cuando hubo terminado con esa operación de limpieza, alargó las manos hacia su cuello y le arregló el nudo de la corbata. Broncano sacó la cabeza por la ventana para ver a quién se refería. «Oh, algo nuevo», dijo. «Arthur no sé qué. Veo que aún sigue pegado a las faldas de esa momia. No durará mucho». «Ah, no sé qué decirte», murmuró Tepic. «Nosotros no sabríamos vivir sin nuestras momias y ya llevamos miles de años así».
Thank you. to move on to Patrick and French translation. Maybe you'd introduce yourself a little bit and your work.
Just a little bit, please. So my name is Patrick Couton. I'm from France, and I'm not a translator by trade because I'm mostly a musician. But I started to translate Terry Pratchett in 1991 or 92, and the first novel by Terry Pratchett that I translated was The Light Fantastic and Not the Color of Magic. But after a while, maybe 2 or 3 years, the French readers asked the French publisher if I could retranslate the first one. So now I've got an enemy, French translator. And after that, I translated every novel in the Discworld series, plus some others, maybe, all in all, maybe 50 books by Terry Pratchett. What else do you want to know? It's time for me to read our translation. Please, okay. Yeah, yes, please. Tu te la portes tout seul, petit père. C'est la règle à l'école. T'es pas dans la balle. Pareil, il y a une idée.
Le gros, la figure comme le bout de chaussure, c'est Couchou.
Fais gaffe à lui. Si t'invites à une collation dans son bureau, n'y va pas. Et qui sait, le gamin avec les cheveux bouclés devant la télé. Il désignait un petit garçon, objet des attentions d'une dame âgée qui avait l'air au bout du rouleau. Elle léchait son mouchoir et lui contournait la figure pour enlever des taches sales. Lorsqu'elle eut terminé, elle lui rectifia sa cravate. Schiller tendit le cou. Oh, un petit nouveau, dit-il. Arthur quelque chose. Il ne peut toujours pas se passer de sa mamie, de ce que je vois. Il ne tiendra pas longtemps. Oh, bon sûr, fut épique. Nous non plus, on ne peut pas se passer de nos mamies. Nous on tient depuis des milliers d'années. és mit tettem, hogy ilyen nagy lesz? Vagy most mondom, vagy ilyen lényeg lett hozzá. Folyamatosan tudom, aki nem válaszolt a csinál. Nem bírják a borszos. Az a fontos, hogy tud, mindig csoda és mindig csoda. Látod ott azt a fazont? Te még követte új barátja, kényült a dugját, de kintet éve csoport diákhoz, hogy a perben lették a szabottnál átcsoportra. Azt a nagy darabon? Olyan arcán, mint a csizmát varázs. Az vicces. Vigyázz rá. Ha meghív a szobájába, kérdés búcsúzni, ne menj bele. Ki az egy iskolai a fotocskénkkel kezdődöttek? Egy aprócska figura mutatott, aki egy kiberintegráció gondrészesének gondoskodásával megnyil a vasem kendőjésre törölgette a feltörő masszatot a fiú arcán. Amikor ezzel végzett, a nő megigazgatta a fiú csúnya kendőjét. Csinálják le, mint a gondolásra. Ott csak egy új diák legyen. Ajtó, hogy ilyen. Úgy látom, még mindig eljön az igazőséghez. Nem fogja sokáig érni. Nos, nem tudom, feleled eddig. Mi is ezt tesz.
The funny thing changes a little.
own text. and if I can stay with you then, and the next one that I find really, really funny is when he says, so your people must be really rich then. And the reply is, no, they stand around, they grow lemons and garlic mostly, and stand around in the streets shouting the rat. And how is that? Because it plays on the idea of saying your people being your parents.
It does look good.
Instead of saying your people are pretty rich, my translation means you're pretty rich at home. Ah, bad. So it works.
Yeah.
It works in French.
Do you find that it's often the case that instead of trying to mimic the joke, you kind of shift it into something slightly different? It seems to work in this case.
So when it says said in French, it means I've never been to commerce, but I understand they're very, very nice people.
Yeah.
They're very agreeable.
Yeah.
Because commerce agréable is a French expression.
So you have actually three layers of using the same word. So not just easy, but you managed to add it.
Because mommy basically to send a Marin cynic. It's rather girl that would be saying this. Literally, it means mother's son. No, mom's son.
Okay.
Mama is the money. And technique slightly misunderstood and said he's a moon's son, which is moon's son. And then the words are longer than the mom, of course. So it's easier to. Somehow to understand it not quite good, quite well.
Okay.
Yes, so I think it works, but not perfectly. I mean, it is a change of the word. So, it's not the same word, but it's easy to make a connection. Yes,
I see. In Spanish.
In Spanish, it works. It's good. He changed the pair of items, mummy and Egyptian mummy. He replaced that by Egyptian mummy and an old lady. So he uses the description of the old lady, but he enhances that a bit. So and then he uses he takes up the concept of the mother. But what stays is the comparison, let's say, between the Egyptian mummy and an old lady. And he says only inside the word momia. So it's not the same word, but it's you can say mommy also like in English for an old lady. So what he did is stick to the meaning and not explain, but just change the words and leave out other idea. It works. It's fine.
Is it funny? Yeah. Small number of characters here, and I noticed that in each language the name
a specific
boat.
One.
Flyboat.
Right. similarly, in the same way, and we did the same way, pronunciation. So it's obvious. Tepic and neos are just Egyptian. How to put it? Egyptian sound, right? Neos, of course, is not a religious, as you know, is God, but he is godly. But it doesn't mean godly in Polish. So it's just the proper name of Egyptian. I don't know, it changed. If you say something, this is Dios, you feel Egyptian. It's something like that. It's not, yes, I think, and Tepic as well. The second one is political decision. Final, of course, is ceremonial. Which is proper for assessment. I believe. And so I decided to leave it as it is, because at the time, it was after the change in Holland, I've seen those karma shop and it was fine. I've seen it, so that anyone can see it. So, yeah. And the political decision is such as, usually I don't want to translate the names of people. Usually the names mean something, but you don't realize what it is. To be on your language, you don't remember that the river pool is a pool of river. Of the water, let's see. What's that? So it is like this. And so Mr. Smith, you don't think he used to be a the meaning is still there, but it doesn't matter. So I decided that the names in the people's names, humans' names, it doesn't matter. Except very special situation was in Angra, there was six people and each one has a name. Who was the name of the profession, but he was not of the... Well, the thatcher was a tailor, and the winner was a baker, that sort of thing. So, of course, then I never translated. But usually, no. I did translate dwarves' names, because they are more, you know, descriptive. But still, probably I will able to do something with my own. If not the situation when they feel that you're in Poland, so.
Thank you. It's clear that you gave it a lot of power. So, before we open the floor for questions from the audience, I'd just like to ask another question, which is that, as Jane pointed out, there's intertextuality in pretty much all of Pratchett's works. So, he draws on Shakespeare here, and anyway, there's a huge list of references which you kind of have to know because they're not made explicit all the time. You just have to know that this is referencing someone, and it kind of is often adapted, so it's not actually a direct quote, but it's just an echo of something. And I was wondering, to what extent did you do the research into this kind of phenomenon before or during the translation process? Oh, really?
Three friends, yes. And then it's quite a lot of information. And of course, well, That's clear. It's a confession. I draw from one of the translations. Luckily, it did quite a lot. I prefer to use the older ones. They're nice. Yeah. Somehow, get the feeling is right.
That's right. How about in Spanish? Can you see a pattern?
For the translation of Shakespeare's lines, I would use the French existing versions, translations, what we call the canonic
translation.
But for some other, for me, or because I'm French, obscure poets from the Elizabeth period, I would adapt and find the same kind of lines in French poets. So for instance, in Lords and Ladies, there are several lines by, I don't remember the names of the poets, English poets. I used just one French poet, but a great one, Victor Hugo. So I had Victor Hugo in my translation. With the same meaning, of course.
Okay. And was it difficult to find?
So I called him on the phone, and he told me he should read Victor Hugo, that book, these poems. And
okay, so it's friends again, it's people you know.
So I have a question about more just a specific thing in one of the books, Eric, but it's kind of a part of the larger theme of a very specific. So in Eric, coming out of
change the actual art of translating through the years, or is it still like a group of people sit down with the book and translate it themselves?
Okay. Have you been affected by the advance in translation technology? Has that changed the way that you work when you're translating?
Very much.
Oh, please, tell us more about it. Okay, the question is about accents and dialects.
basically.
Sometimes, yes.
Tell the clearly used the dialect of Hungarian.
Sometimes it's extra explanation, or there's like
once told me, the shorter, the better. For that matter.
Okay. They were the same changes to print.
So that's why I tried to translate very briefly.
In French, at least 10%. Yeah.